us to discover the key to our survival, it now becomes imperative that we identify, harness, and develop those energies of the noosphere which are of an intercentric nature. That is, center to center, or soul to soul, not just mind to mind. This brings us to the problem of love, which Teilhard defines as cosmic energy. Love, the affinity of being with being, is not peculiar to man. It is a universal property of all life and thus embraces all forms of organized matter. If there were no internal tendency to unite, even at a rudimentary level, as for example the attraction of atom to atom, molecule to molecule, or cell to cell, love could not appear at a higher level within us. Recognizing the presence of love in ourselves, we must, as we did with consciousness, presume its presence in everything that is. The forces of love drive the fragments of the universe to seek each other, so that the world may come into being. If this is so, love in all its subtle varieties is radial energy. Thus, Omega, by partially immersing itself into the heart of each element, draws the universe into psychical convergence to itself. Teilhard says that love is the fundamental impulse of life. Or to put it another way, love is the only natural medium in which the upward course of evolution can proceed. It is through love and within love that we must search for our deepest self, in the life-giving coming together of humankind. Love is the free and imaginative outflowing of the spirit over all unexplored paths. It links those who love in bonds that unite but do not destroy, causing them to discover in their mutual contact an exaltation capable of stirring in the very core of their being all that they possess of uniqueness and of creative power. Love alone can unite living beings so as to complete and fulfill them. For it alone joins them by what is deepest in themselves. All we need is to imagine our ability to love developing until it embraces the totality of men and of the earth. Yet is it not really impossible to love everything and everyone? Well, Teilhard tells us that this is not as preposterous as it first seems, for it is achievable, but only through cosmic love. Not only is a universal or cosmic love psychologically possible, it constitutes the only complete and final way in which we are capable of loving. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul. This is the greatest commandment. It comes first, but the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. Or to paraphrase, love each other, recognizing the same God who is being born in each one of you. These words, uttered some 2,000 years ago, now begin to unveil themselves as the indispensable structural law of what we call evolution. Hence, they enter the scientific field of cosmic energy and its essential laws. We have seen that the rise of consciousness has been dependent on the physical earth. Because the Omega point transcends both time and space, evolution cannot reach fulfillment on earth except through a point of dissociation. And yet, ahead of us, we now see that there is a psychical center which is gathering together the final surge of consciousness. Thus, we are introduced to what Teilhard says is an inevitable and fantastic event now starting to take form. An event which comes closer with each passing day. The end of all life on our Earth. The death of the physical planet. The final stage of the phenomenon of man. Catastrophic end of the world. Sidereal cataclysm through cosmic mishap. Onslaughts of microbes. Counter-evolution. Sterility. Nuclear war. Or slow death in our earthly prison, a long, drawn-out senility. Each of these represents a perfectly plausible way of coming to an end. Teilhard further states emphatically, however, that on the basis of all we know from evolution, we have nothing whatsoever to fear from any premature accident or failure. We have higher reasons for being certain that they will not occur. The presence of reflection in the universe would be incomprehensible if the infinite and the infinitesimal did not conspire to nourish and sustain, to the very end, the consciousness that has arisen between the two. How then could man come to an end before his biologically appointed hour, or deteriorate, unless the world aborts itself? Thus we conclude that man will attain the goal, however improbable it might appear to us. Mankind has extraordinary possibilities ahead of it. Since crossing the threshold of reflection, we have entered a completely new phase of evolution. Thanks to the powerful capacity of reflective thought to gather together and combine into one conscious effort all the individual human particles. We are faced with a sort of collective exaltation, human vibrations resonating by the million. An entire layer of consciousness bringing pressure to bear simultaneously on the future and on the whole storehouse of a million years of thought. Have we ever attempted to realize what such magnitudes represent? When, under this increasing psychical tension on the surface of the earth, enough elements have been grouped together, evolution will reach such intensity and such quality that the whole of mankind will be compelled to reflect upon itself at a single point. In other words, the movement will forsake its earthly foothold so as to pivot itself on its transcendent center. This will be the termination and the fulfillment of the spirit of the earth. The end of the world, the total internal introversion upon itself of the noosphere that has simultaneously attained the furthest limit of its complexity and consciousness, in an ecstasy utterly transcending the entire length, breadth, and depth of the visible universe. The end of the world, the upset of equilibrium, releasing the mind from its material matrix so that, fulfilled at long last, it will center itself thereafter with all its weight in God.